Hey everyone, and welcome back to another news update. Warcraft 3's refund process is a minefield. Phil Spencer wants frame rate over visuals. Good man. The greediest franchise just got a little bit greedier and a whole bunch more. Yes, it is time for another edition of the Roundup. We do these twice a week alongside four more reports and deep dives. So throw us a like if you'd like to help us out with the algorithm. And if you're new, that sub button is pretty darn good too. Okay, with that, let's roll. If any company was hoping for a new year, new me, I think it was probably Blizzard Entertainment, but no such luck for them, as we covered in yesterday's video. The long-awaited and delayed release of Warcraft 3 Reforged has been met with mostly negative feedback because of, well, glitches, technical issues, very iffy community, censorship, measures, a whole bunch of things they kind of said would be there that aren't there, generally poor quality. It's a bit of a mess. So it's no surprise that people want refunds for this travesty of a game, but multiple reports have surfaced that Blizzard are actively banning people on the official Warcraft forums for helping others to actually get a refund. Now, it's worth noting here from the outset that these are like reports based on Reddit posts, social media stuff, so it is hard to verify how widespread of an issue that this is. So I think it's responsible to make you very aware of that. Now, as an example, one user on a backup forum account was claiming that their main account was banned for 2 weeks after trying to help other people find the refund request options. Now, this post uses the ban as confirmation that Blizzard know they need a bad game, that they need to silence people. That's the quote. And generally, that's circling a lot. Now, aside from that, there's other issues with refunds. A pretty common one is that Blizzard's site doesn't actually list any orders as being eligible for refunds. Players instead have to resort to manually opening customer support tickets with Blizzard in the hopes of that Blizzard CF staffer actually giving them the refund. And some people have reported success with live chat, but other people have not. And overall, I think this play of not making the refund experience user-friendly is very obvious on Steam. If you buy a game and there's loads of problems, it's pretty much an automatic refund and it works. But with this, there's a bit of friction. And you know what? Friction is it's a very useful tool sometimes. Because if people think, oh, I've got to talk to a live chat agent, I've got to go through a bunch of hoops, maybe I've got to phone someone, oh, I couldn't be bothered, then there's going to be that apathy. And that apathy might lead to them just, you know, not getting their refund, which of course would be good for Blizzard. Ultimately, yeah, Blizz should have a refund system that is, you know, there with, say, what Valve are doing for Steam. And it's times like this where you really see that they kind of benefit from having an archaic refund system, and that kind of sucks. Next up, though, it's earnings call season, and this gives us a fantastic glimpse at just, you know, how the industry is actually doing by the numbers and what the companies are self-reporting, and this is for the period ending December 2019. Now, while an actual number was not forthcoming, Microsoft confirmed that Game Pass subscribers doubled, and that their new monthly active users record for Xbox Live was actually on off-console strength, and that basically means PC's doing really well for them. Then for EA, they had a good time. Live services did well over the holidays, which isn't really a surprise. They're still super proud of Apex Legends. Digital sales up year on year 49%. Net bookings were up, were actually 77% digital, which is also very good for them. Star Wars was a big performer as well. Battlefront 2 actually performed above their Q3 expectations thanks to its new updates, and then Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order was a major success. We've got sales numbers. It sold 8 million units, and they are expecting 10 million units by the end of March. Now, their stock did dip just a little bit because of a quiet Q1 2020, but they're picking things up shortly. This fiscal year is going to have 4 non-sports titles and 4 from third parties and indies. We're thinking that could be a BioWare remaster, Command & Conquer remaster, Medal of Honor VR, and something from Criterion. Criterion really haven't been doing much lately, so I wouldn't be surprised if something happened there. But overall, a good one for them. Of course, screw FIFA Ultimate Team thoroughly, but it's good to see the more customer-friendly Star Wars efforts actually doing well for them. And personally, I just really hope that the Fallen Order success convinces, say, BioWare to have a bit more creative freedom when it comes to their game form. So that's good stuff. Then finally, Nintendo have had 30% of Switch users buy Pokemon Sword and Shield, bringing in 16.06 million sales. That's colossal, and it also looks like there won't be a Switch Pro update this year. But that's not all from Nintendo, because as I said, the greediest franchise, Pokemon, has got greedier. Do you want to pay $16 a year to solve a problem that they've created? Well, Pokemon Home details have been revealed. There's going to be a new version of Home native to the Switch, and a second version for mobile. And even if you're not a Nintendo person, and I think it's relevant just seeing what the hell's going on here, because it's a bit wild. So the mobile version is used for transferring your Pokemon from the older Pokemon Bank storage system into the Nintendo Switch Pokemon games, of course provided that those Pokemon are actually present in the newer Pokemon games. Now, trading can only take place via the mobile app. The Switch version, meanwhile, is used for transferring Pokemon from Pokemon Let's Go, Pikachu, and Eevee from those games into Sword and Shield. And that again is provided that those are Pokemon that are supported in Sword and Shield. Now, there is a free version of Home, yes, but it very much is a premium service. So the free version is incredibly limited, right? Like, you basically, well, you aren't able to transfer Pokemon from Pokemon Bank with the free version. So I guess they just sit in storage until you get the credit card out. Great. Then the free version only allows for 30 Pokemon to be stored, expanding to 6,000 with the paid version. And in terms of pricing, one month is $2.99, 3 months is $4.99, and a full year is $15.99. And that's a pretty significant jump up from Pokemon Bank's $4.99 per year subscription fee, especially considering the, just the limited additional functionality. I mean, transferring from Pokemon Go, that won't even be supported at launch. At least Pokemon Bank is going to be free for a month whenever Home releases to make those transfers a little bit easier on the wallet, but it's just another example of, honestly, the core Pokemon fans will take anything. They know this, and they're just like, you know what? Can we get another $16 from all of our hardcore fans? Yes. And they will. And that's just how that's going to work, I suppose. Next up, though, some really good stuff to hear. Phil Spencer, he sure is more of a gamer type than the old Xbox League Don Matrick. He's going around talking about frame rates being more important than resolution, something that I think almost all core gamers would very much agree with. So he confirmed to, it's Deviver.com, that the feel of games is something that they want to have more of a focus on, not just throwing more pixels up in the screen. He says that Xbox has never tried to limit what developers actually do on the platform, but that rather, their game is to offer them tools and support and the capability to try out new things. And Spencer concludes by saying, and this is the bit that really matters to us, that with the Xbox One X, they're at a point in the generation where games look amazing, but he wants games to feel as amazing as they look. And you know what that is? That's an admission that what we need is frames per second. And I think this is great. This is, pro game experience leadership. This is what we need. And here's the thing. FPS, you only really feel that when you're actually playing the game. It doesn't really show up as much in trailers, TV ads, and screenshots. And that's a lot of why, visuals have been prioritized over frame rate. And now we've got one of the pillars of the industry saying, no, the visuals are great right now. What we need is games that feel better. And I've got to wonder if, Xbox having more of a cross-platform thing now. They're seeing those strength of PC. They maybe saw with Halo 5 just how much better of a sort of a multiplayer experience that was when it was 60 FPS. Maybe the same goes for Master Chief Edition stuff as well. So overall, that's just incredible news. And the more the industry pushes that in that direction, the better. And if we can get our big Sony exclusives with a performance mode and a quality mode like we've seen with some of the remasters, and I think God of War as well, that would be great to see on the PS5. Imagine if you had God of War looking as good as its quality mode, but with the performance of its performance mode. That would be an incredible gaming experience. Of course, so the final thing that I'd add there is that consoles are often played in TVs. A lot of TVs don't have game modes that are that great, and a lot of people don't even know the term game mode off. So seeing something there on the console level to try to educate users, that would probably be a nice thing to see. Anyway, next, an interesting one. So this week we learned that Plague Inc., the strategic disease simulator, has experienced a sharp uptick in player numbers, of course, during, real life disease outbreaks. And developer Nademic Creations, they credit the increases right now to people seeking to find out more about how diseases actually spread in the world and to understand the complexities of viral outbreaks. And this very same pattern they've seen before has happened again in the wake of the coronavirus outbreak. So they, of course, told people not to take their game as being like a complete scientific tool or anything like that. But it's interesting because that player count really did spike. DAUs in Steam are up 148% month on month. The peak player count has also reached a new high with nearly 18K, which shattered their previous record of 4,600. And also this week, it became the best-selling app in China. So that suggests, many have suggested that people are downloading that game to sort of cope with fears and to just learn a little bit more about viruses in the wake of the coronavirus, which of course right now is a lot more concentrated in China. And then next up, I suppose we've got a bit of a theme this week with game devs addressing real-world issues. And I think this is a really interesting story. So House House, the studio behind Untitled Goose Game, have announced on Twitter that they're going to be pledging at least 1% of their income to Australia's indigenous groups. And it's kind of an interesting story. This pledge is in line with the Pay the Rent movement, and that is a business-level commitment to paying 1% of income as rent to Aboriginal communities. Now, their tweet states that their video game is like was made on stolen tribal land. I don't want to butcher their name out of respect. I just wouldn't do a good job. And they're encouraging others to sign up to the scheme. And you know, it's interesting. House House, they are not shy about making statements like these. The end credits for Untitled Goose Game actually contains very similar wording to their Pay the Rent tweet. And they also, you know, called on people to vote for the Labour Party in the UK general election of December 2019. I'll be real with you here. You know, on that particular election one, I mean, look, I'll just say I've got no love for that incarnation of Labour's leadership. So I would probably have disagreements with the House House people on that. But you know what? Here's the important thing. I respect people being honest about what they feel and actually backing that up with action. Their freedom to do that is my freedom to do that. And I think that's extremely important. And I know there's this sort of reflexive no politics in my video games thing going on, but personally, I do respect people being honest about what they feel, what they think, and backing that up with real action. I think charity is a good thing. I respect them doing that. And if that's what House House wants to do, then good on them. I absolutely support that. Certainly, I do not want a world of safe, anemic fan service that is just marketable as hell, but has no essence, no core in it. And I'd worry that if we just are totally scared of having any real-world-like events cropping up in games or, you know, any commentary in those things, that would probably be bad for games, you know, as an art form, and that certainly is not what I want. Though I suppose I would say, like, whenever those, like, themes crop up in a game, you know, I think it's better done when it's, like, complex and deep and isn't just the kind of, you know, overt, very blunt statement. I think that stuff's obviously just a little bit less creative and interesting. Anyway, on to Stadia. So, Guilt, their big exclusive, is going to be added to the Stadia Pro lineup for February alongside Metro Exodus. And this week, they exceeded 40 days without a new game announcement or release. And while owners allegedly have over 120 games and 10 exclusives to look forward to in this year, nothing concrete has been announced yet. Now, in contrast, Microsoft's Project xCloud, which is still in its preview, added 3 games this week. So, yes, Stadia is still not looking particularly great for customers. Anyway, next up, we've got a really good story. So, Doom Eternal's creative director confirmed that there will be no microtransactions in the game. He said, "Eternal is a $60 game, not a free-to-play game or a mobile game. We are giving you a complete experience with no store, just like you'd expect." And that's what we want to hear, right? Now, the game, you know, will include cosmetic items, but these are supposed to be earned through the gameplay experience, and they won't have an impact on gameplay. So hopefully they actually stick to that. Hopefully there are no hijinks of the multiplayer. Currently, it seems like the multiplayer's thing does not have microtransactions bolted on, even though there is, like, seasonal stuff for people to do. So we'll have to see how it ends up, but certainly that is what I want to hear. And now that they've said that, you know, if that promise is maybe forced to be broken by their publisher, well, you know, they've already drawn their line in the sand, let's just say. So that's it for today's video. Warcraft 3, a whole bunch of interesting stories, a whole bunch of earnings calls. Let me know what you think. If you're interested in the War 3 situation, check out yesterday's video. If you're interested in the original Blizzard spirit being a little bit carried forth, the video from the day before, that's a good one. And hit that sub button because tomorrow we will be talking about the best upcoming games in the first half of 2020. And also some games that, you know, if you're a bit sad about the delays, that we recommend you play instead of those games while you wait. That's it for me. Thank you for watching. I'll see you next time.